Thank you very much, sir, and very good evening to all of you. It's been a pleasure coming here for more reasons than one. For one, very early in my life, very many of you may not know this, I spent the first 3 years of my life in Orissa. My father was a bank officer. He was posted in Raigada at his first posting. And I actually studied my LKG in Raigada before we were transferred to Chennai. So I have a relationship with very fond memories of Raigada. And in fact, today also in our family, Raigada and Orissa are a very special place in our family. Today, it's almost been about 85 years I've been playing sports. It's been quite a while since I've taken up sport. And this journey has been fantastic for me. There was a time when I won the Olympic that one of the newspapers actually said that the day I picked up my racket, I believed that I would be a badminton player. I was to be a badminton player. I was the winner of the first game. I will talk about it later. But the reality was, it was only by chance that I got this score. I was playing cricket like everybody during the 80s, 80s, World Cup. I was 85, I was playing cricket and broke some window games. My mother thought he should go and play some sport because they were there. We went to the state actually to join the cricket. Cricket admissions open and we didn't have any information. So we asked. So they asked us. So we went to the other side and we went to the tennis courts. And parents later decided against it because there were too many cars parked outside. They decided it was a rich man's sport, it's not for us. So we went to the badminton court and it was empty. So that's how I got into badminton. So one of the things which I realized after I won the All England was reading the newspaper is never trust the press. But the reality is I joined in a summer camp at that time. Today we call upon Hyderabad is a badminton capital of the country. But the reality is when I started playing, there wasn't even a national champion from Hyderabad. So the journey for me and the reality is that even if I had a dream, I don't remember that dream. But even if I had a dream, I don't think it would have been much bigger than being a state champion because we didn't think that it was possible. It all started, I don't know how, today connecting the dots back. I joined with a group of four of them in a summer camp, four friends. All I thought was I needed to be better than them. For some reason, I thought I should be better than them. And very early in life, I realized that if I worked harder than my opposition, I would be working harder. If I work harder than my opposition, I would be better than them. Every day they would come at 6 o'clock, I would go in at 5:45. They would finish at 7:30, I would go play till 7:45. They would go back and I am imagining that they would be watching TV and I would do all practice. And slowly I kept working hard and then within a year I started beating them. And I went to play the state championship. Soon to realize that there were another four people who were waiting at the state championship who were better than me. But the principle of hard work and discipline remained the same. And the same happened 5 years later when I went to the national. Then the next year I went to the nationals and I realized that there were another bunch of people who were better than me. But the principle of hard work remained the same. I needed to work harder than my opposition and that's when I would win. And I won the nationals and I went to my first international event. Things were not so easy because my mother was tough. She wanted academics and education together. It was even tougher by my brother because he went to IIT, so things made my life even more difficult. So the standards of academics at home were very high, but luckily I had a lot of support from my parents. And they said, we don't want you to be like your brother. We don't want you to be first in class, but ensure that you get about 60-70% and we are happy. So luckily, I would make those marks and I would get to play sport. And I continued to play sport. But the thing was that we were not still sure that I would continue playing sport. I still went on to college thinking that I will do a maths, physics, chemistry and an engineering class. My brother went to IIT, I wrote the exam, luckily I failed. And there was this 1 year opportunity to play sport. And within this year, things changed. I went on, the year was 91. I won the junior nationals. And I got a job in Tata Steel in Jamshedpur. And that is when literally my badminton career had started. So you know how much away the press was from the reality. So things went on. I joined Tata Steel. Now I was sure that I will be a badminton player. And then I had an opportunity to play my first international event in Malaysia, Singapore and Indonesia. It was a series. Now also we have that. It's the same super series now. They used to be major rankings then. I went there to play my first international tournament. We were a group of 18 of us who went there. I was the youngest of them all. I was an 18-year-old. And all of us had lost in the first round on the first day. And we all sat down in this hotel, Emerald, which was right next to the stadium Negara, to see and describe and think that how good the Chinese, Indonesians and Koreans were and how high they jump, how hard they hit and how it's impossible for us to win against them. I was the youngest of the lot. And in all my childish enthusiasm, I got up and said, "Main jeet ke dikhaunga." Everybody pounced on me. They said, "Bachcha hai, bahut chakra hai, jaldi seekh jayega." I got out of that room saying, "Main jeet ke dikhaunga." And if I'm proud of something in my life, it's the fact that till the end of my career, I had that kid in me alive. And that for me was the prize. It didn't happen so easily because I lost a lot of matches in between. 91 to 93, I was kind of from a junior national champion in 91 to 93. I was the best senior player in the country in 94 when I went to play the national games in Pune. I was playing the final. I was supposed to play the finals in the evening and I was playing the semi-finals in the morning, where I collided with my partner on court in a doubles game. I was moving backwards, he was moving sideways, he didn't see me. He landed on my foot. I twisted my knee and had an anterior cruciate ligament tear at age 20. For somebody who thought I was invincible and I was strong, this was a huge blow to me. And nobody before me had ever come back from a knee injury of that nature ever. So for me, it was tough times. It took me a year to come back and work to come back. I had was lucky and fortunate to have a doctor called Ashok Rajgopal who helped me out, and my parents and to support me. But it took me a year to come back. I had another fall again 2 years later after I won the nationals in 96. And another surgery in 98. So things were up and down and up and down. And in 98, I was at a training place where now I was the senior most of the group. And I was talking to a bunch of kids about how we can beat the Chinese and the Indonesians. And one of the kids out of the group got up and said, "Bhaiya, aap to har baar bolte ho ki hum jeetenge, but lagta nahi ki hamare saath hoega. Aapka to ghutna 3 baar toot chuka. Aur hame bhi nahi lagta hai ki hame kuch ho payega." I moved my training base and I was almost alone working in Sai Bangalore with a coach called Ganguly Prasad. And I really went on for the next 3 years, whatever medals I won, whether it's the Commonwealth, Asian Championships or the All England happened during that time. And in 2002, I had another surgery on my right knee this time, which was an overuse injury, because over the years of my three left knee surgeries, I put too much pressure on my right knee and my right knee basically worn out. And every day I would go to the stadium and check if my left knee was paining. I would train. If my left knee was paining, I would not train and coach. And if my right knee body was all right, I would train. If my body was hurting, I would coach. That's how I slowly drifted into coaching. But there's an interesting couple of learnings which have happened. Till the time I was thinking about the four people and thinking about competition, I was tense. I was spying on what they were doing and trying to work harder than them. But the day the four people didn't matter and I wanted to be the best of what I could be, that is when I got the best results in my life. For me, this was a great learning experience, because for me, it was about being the best of what I could be, which gave me the results. For me to infer, maybe competition can get us maybe state level or national level, but competing with ourselves is what gives us world-class results. This is for me a great insight which I have looked at. In all my career, I always struggled with very, very simple things in my life. Aap stadium jaate ho, stadium mein watchman nahi aaya. To bahut sare log talk about big things. Today we talk about psychologists, physiologists, nutritionalists, biomechanics, kinesiologists, all of these things. But my challenges in life were much simpler. Stadium gaya, stadium band hai. Watchman nahi aaya. Stadium gaya, pahuncha nahi laga hai. Shuttles nahi hai. Coach nahi aaya. Ground mein gaya, ground mein paani hai. Ground mein shaadi hua hai. Simple things were bigger challenges in my life. We want to go to the swimming pool. Pool mein paani nahi hai. Pool. So these were the big challenges. And I wasn't the most talented of the group as well. So my belief was, if I could achieve this, I'm sure many of the others could achieve this. And all my life I tried various things and learned a lot from trial and error. So what eventually happened was, I figured the formula, which was important and correct, but I couldn't use it because my body didn't give me, mera body mera saath nahi diya. So I said, if I had won the All England at 27, and I was regretting that had I known this formula when I was younger, I probably would have grown and maybe won many more in my life. And that is how this whole coaching journey has started. So every day I would go. If my knee was hurting, I would check my left knee hurting, right knee not hurting. Then I would go and coach. If body was all right, I would train. So initial days were very tight. I would do three times I would play, one time I would coach. Slowly that became the reverse ratio. One day I would play and 3 days I am coaching, because the body didn't recover. And slowly I drifted into coaching. I started in 2003 and formally in 2004 with a bunch of kids. The oldest of that group was Parupalli Kashyap, who's won the 2014 Commonwealth Games. And the youngest of the group was PV Sindhu. And in that group in between, we had people like Saina, who was about 13, Sai Praneet, Guru Sai Dutt, Sikki Reddy, Sumit Reddy. All of these were from that initial group of about 25 kids whom I was coaching. And almost 10 of that 25 have played top 30 in the world. And this is something which is really... Things didn't come very easy. There were a lot of challenges. Government had given a piece of land. Now I had to build the academy there. There was not much funding there. Luckily, there was a person who gave an initial check of 2 crores, and we started construction, believing that as time goes, I would be able to gather more funds. But it wasn't so easy. I went to a lot of corporates. I would wear a shirt and a suit and a nice presentation and believe that presentations will give you money. People said, sport doesn't figure into our CSR. They said, health, education, girl, child, all of these are, but not sport. I said, okay. Many people actually said that Indians don't have it in them to be world-class athletes. Many also said, Gopi, we know you, you're dedicated, but I don't think you can be a good coach. So I went very disappointed. As an All England champion, you are used for photographs and signing autographs. And suddenly, there was this rejection and dejection all the while. And the final straw was when I went to Bombay to a certain office. And the person, after 3 days of me waiting, because the chairman had said yes, the CFO finally evaluated the file and said, badminton doesn't have it in it to be a world sport. And he said, it doesn't have the eyeballs to be a world sport, and I don't think Indians can be champions at this sport. I had tears in my eyes. I walked off, went straight home that night from Bombay, called my parents at 10 o'clock, and I said, I can't do this anymore. And we had a house in Jubilee Hills of Hyderabad, which is in 1,000 yards. I said, we're going to sell the house. They luckily agreed. And the next day, we didn't sell the house, but my father, being a banker, we mortgaged my house. We got a 3 crore loan on it, and that's why we actually did to finish and complete the academy. Thanks to that decision that night, we were very happy to actually have taken that decision, because had it not been for the decision, I don't know how far this whole journey would have gone. So reality is, in life, sometimes you have to risk all you have and believe what you have, what you do, to actually come back stronger or achieve big things in life. So for me, this was a very important thing. The same happened in my career. I prepared for the 2000 Sydney Olympics as though it was the biggest event in my life. I worked, meditated, visualized all of these things. And in 2000, I went to the Olympics thinking that I'm going to win the Olympics, because I had imagined, close my eyes, and I would imagine that I'm actually on the podium and the medal was being given to me. And I totally believed that this was going to happen, because every day in the morning I would get up and visualize that I'm going to win, because I'd read books during my days of injury about visualization and meditation and yoga and a guru, and I said, this is going to happen. And at that point of time, I believed it is going to happen. And I went to the Olympics, and strangely, the flooring at the Olympics was a concrete floor. And with my knee the way it was, after I played my first round match, the next day there was a ball behind my knee and the whole body was swollen. After multiple massages and ice baths and brufens, all I got was 101 temperature the next day. And I lost my pre-quarter finals at the Olympics. So for the next few months, those were the saddest moments of my life. And I thought that nothing is going to work for me, and all of this doesn't help. And I just left it, got back to training without any expectations. And a few months later, the All England happens out of the blue. Maybe it's not when we want it that it happens, but when we deserve it, it happens. So for me, the brightest moments of life come after the darkest of moments. The biggest of tests, if we pass, then the biggest of successes also come. So it's very important to keep pushing beyond those boundaries. And that is what gives us that big successes later. Sometimes you have to believe and go beyond for us to actually get these beliefs. So for me, life has given me so much more. For somebody who got into sport never knowing what the future holds, and keeps climbing one step at a time, I realize the next is possible. And it's been the same journey for me in the coaching field as well. I've been very fortunate that in my life, I had coaches who supported me, I had parents who supported me, I have students, and I also had tough times with governments. We had a court case with the government run for 6 years because somebody wanted to build apartments in our ground. We fought for 6 hours, but whenever we've had tough times, there's somebody or the other God has sent to actually help us out. And for me, I strongly believe that if you really want it, nature will conspire to help you. The quote in The Alchemist is true, not that I read it and I'm saying it, but actually I know it and I read it later, because I think it's something which is very, very important. For me, sport has given everything, and today whatever I am is about sport, and that's very evident, I think. But for me, the entire concept of sport and its understanding has changed a lot more than what I started off with. Because when I started off, and for many, many years till 2015, I thought sport was about excellence, and it is about excellence and bringing the medal, which was very critical. But I met a young girl during my coaching sessions who taught me another dimension of sport, which for me has changed my entire approach to life as well. I threw a shuttle to a kid to catch and throw back. She failed to catch it. And I was annoyed. "Can't you catch?" I said. And she fumbled again. And I just brushed her off and moved to the other kids to coach them. Later she came back and asked me, "Sir, teach me how to catch." I would never have imagined that such kind of a scenario would come in my life. I read this book called Physical Literacy. It is about how and when we progress in life, whether it's crawling, walking, running, throwing, catching, balancing, kicking. If all of these were a pattern, like we have alphabets, words, sentences, words, letters, sentences, paragraphs, grammar, poems, like that. So if that is alphabetical literacy, and if addition, subtractions and multiplications was numerical literacy, this I would call it as physical literacy. We in the last 50 years have grown alphabetically and numerically, but there is a population which is coming which is actually not grown physically. And for all of us, many of us in this generation, nature took care of us physically to be literate. But now the connect with nature is going lesser and lesser, and it's very important that we get our physical literacy back as a primary focus before we even get to alphabetical and numerical literacy. For any sport to be played, to be physically literate is critical. So the question is, why should sport be played in the first place? Why is sport important? What is sport about? Let's look at it a little differently. In education, when a bunch of kids are going, you have special classes for whom? For who's weak in class, we have special classes. But in sport, you have special classes for who's good in sport. So that's one fundamental difference between education and sport. The other fundamental difference we have is that if you fail in a class, exams happen once in a year maybe, or if you fail in a class, the school tries to hide the marks. The parents try to hide the marks, saying he'll pass in September and he's promoted. Push kar do. But in sport, you're a failure, you're a failure. and the world makes you sit in front and say you're a loser. And if you're able to come out of that, then your fear of failure and your fear of and your talent to overcome those failures is strengthened by that sports victory or loss. So life's lessons of failure are taught by sport much better than anything else. So sport is fundamentally important from that perspective. Today, for health, for happiness, for life skills, sport is fundamental, and nothing can teach sport better. There is enough and more scientific evidence which shows that physical activity builds neurons, and people who play sport are smarter in education as well. So there's enough reasons to get our kids introduced to sport more and more. Most kids should play in schools. We should have our curriculum which is more rounded, which actually gives a couple of hours every day to ensure that we play sport. This is fundamental. There is another aspect which is very important. All my life, I would look at talent. I would think, is this kid talented? Are you talented? Are you talented? And I would keep looking to see how to identify talent. But as a group, as a state, as a country, as parents, if we had 10 kids, do we see which kid is talented out of the 10? And are we happy with one kid being good and 9 being rejected and bad? We want all our kids to be talented. So I think as a state, the word talent identification should be replaced by the word talent mapping. We should believe that all our kids are talented. It is fundamentally important to see that we don't reject any kids. It's important for us to place those kids in each of these things. So sport is about winners, but it's about winning in all aspects. Sport builds champions, not only the ones who win medals, but if there were medals built given for learning life skills, if there were medals given for improving health, if there is medals given for winning about failure, learning about failure and victory, then every kid who plays sport is a champion. And that is what as a state we should look at, that people play sport. Unfortunately, we don't give medals for all of these things, but whether we give medals or not, each kid is a champion. Some of them might get medals, is the fundamental understanding we need. So at a base level, we need to ensure that all kids are physically literate, they play sport. All kids play sport. Some of those kids who have an innate talent to compete, who have this rigor to go out and push themselves, they are identified and selected and given the best of training to be and compete against the best in the world. But many of those who don't make it to that level should also be given a safety net to ensure that they don't feel rejected and bad that they have played sport during the prime time of their lives. So these are some of the things which I've always thought would be very helpful. Not that I have thought of these things through the journey, but today looking back, I look at a whole sequence of things happening, and when I connect these dots, it's something which is really amazing for this journey. So it comes back to one question, and I think Orissa has done phenomenally well. And a few visionary leaders understand this better than anybody else. Why sport? Kya milta hai khel ke? Why should we pump money into sport? For every nation, community, state to prosper, pride is important. And every time we have an Indian winning, or a Orissaite winning, or our community person winning, we feel pride in that. And in that bucket of pride, sports plays a very, very important role. So for that reason, sport is important. Sport is important because it is the only thing which can actually lift an entire nation up. So there's a word which Uma Bharti had said when I won the All England and came back. She did a very nice aarti at home, and she put a tilak and she said, in Hindi, the words might be a little dicey when I say it. She said, "Hum kitne paise se is shan ko hum tolenge? It's priceless what you've brought to us." The day Sindhu won the medal, the pride with which each Indian got to work, the happiness with which each person walked back to his office, the way, the day any Indian team wins a cricket match or a hockey match or a football match, or any sprinter from Orissa wins those big races, any hockey player wins, the pride with which an entire state looks up, how do you quantify that moment? So it's productivity multiplied a million times. So that is what sports bring in. So there's a huge value, and few leaders have actually done it. I don't know who the Jamaican Prime Minister is. I don't know who the Brazilian is. But yes, I know who a Usain Bolt is. I know who a Ronaldo is. So that is what sport does. People may not actually know who the Chief Minister of Jharkhand is, but they will know who a Dhoni is. I think that is what sport brings in. So for any state community to be prominent, sport is very, very fundamental. And a few visionary leaders have actually taken that route. Nelson Mandela talked about sports so great in his journey. And the Orissa state sponsoring the hockey team was a fantastic idea. Conducting such events is a fantastic idea. So I think there's a huge value which sports bring. So when you conduct an event, we look at it, I'll just take 2 minutes. We've conducted events. So it comes out as sports ka event kar rahe, kya fayda hua? When 500 people come to a society to play a tournament, and they will book hotels, they will travel by local transport, they will actually eat locally, they will buy some handicrafts, and they will go. That is economy which the state can benefit from, which the city can benefit from. So sport is not about the sports department. It is about the municipal administration getting in together. It's the rural development which is coming together. It's education which comes together, health which comes together. Because if you don't build stadiums, you have no option but to build hospitals. You want to look at it proactively and build stadiums and playgrounds, or you want to build medical and health facilities? The option is ours. I think we need to look at it differently. Physical culture, which we talked about in yoga, the Aurobindo and the mother talked about it as physical culture. Physical literacy is a term coined by Margaret Whitehead. And our own Raj Yoga, all of these are very, very important elements which we need to look at. Sport needs to be looked at with a different eye. Investments in sport are million-fold beneficial, and it's important to look at it from a positive aspect of attacking the problem rather than finding negative solutions to the problem. With these words, I'm very, very happy to be here. Thank you all so much, and I'll take some questions. Thank you.